We're back for another episode of Bring Me Your Torch. I'm Jesse.
And I'm Elaine.
And we're super happy to bring you our third episode. And with each episode, we bring a few more surprises. Last time, we had a theme song and we had a mic. And now, we have a website.
Woohoo!
And it's pretty easy to remember, I think. Elaine, what's the name of our podcast?
Bring Me Your Torch.
So what do you think the name of our website is?
I don't know. What is it?
BringMeYourTorch.com.
Do you think it might be BringMeYourTorch.com?
That's exactly what it is. You can go there for all the updates we have on our new episodes. And just to learn a little bit more about what's happening in the world of pop culture, celebrities, reality TV, yada, yada, yada. But, like always, let's go to Survivor. Thoughts? Ideas?
I really loved it. I adored this episode. I think John Rocker went out a little bit too early.
I think I have a controversial opinion on John Rocker in this episode.
Well, the thing about it is he really didn't do anything wrong.
That's exactly it. I was ready to hate the guy. I mean, I still don't like him, but we'll go into that. But he got really railroaded in this episode, I think.
Actually, my question is, and do you want to recap it or do you want to just get straight into the nitty gritty?
Well, you know, let's start with the nitty gritty. Why not? And then go back and talk a little bit about what happened in the episode.
I have a strong feeling that production may have edited out some of the things that he said to the other tribe. And that's what incited Natalie to go.
I did read online, I don't know if it's true, that in the commercials they had shown him making fun of her weight or something like that. So...
I think so, because I think he may have said something and she instantly was like, you're homophobic. This isn't the 90s type.
And I think maybe if you've seen The Amazing Race, both the sisters were really outspoken. So I think she probably said something and then
to get a reaction.
Then he went nuts on her and then back and forth. But okay, let's move on back now. That's kind of like in a TV show when they show you the climax right in the beginning and then they show you how he got there. So, beginning, it was a really, really big day for Cuyopa. They actually won a competition.
Finally.
The only one they won. And
Cheapers.
And who won it? My boy, Wes. He's my pick to win it all.
Well, because he was playing against his geezer dad. I mean, no offense, but...
And, you know, it actually was... I found it to be really touching when they won because, you know, I'm a pretty emotional guy. I come from a family where you wear your heart in your sleeve. And towards the end there, his father, Keith, started really breaking down and... According to Wes, it doesn't happen very often.
I guess ever since he was saying his grandfather died, they've been getting sad and emotional. And
I mean, it's nice, right?
Is it?
Well, not that his grandfather died, but it's nice that you can show that kind of emotion because...
All right, let's keep it moving.
Yeah, sorry.
Yeah, it's we're not all as emo as Jesse's over here.
But the big thing was, before that even started, they got there and they saw the new tribe. And Jeremy, your guy, Jeremy, was... pissed.
Well, yeah, because his wife was no longer there.
Yeah, I mean, I would be mad too, but, you know, I mean, that...
But really, was it John Rocker's responsibility to keep her safe? I mean, did he have that much of a sway?
Well, that goes back to when we called it being railroaded. I mean, at this point, I think it's kind of like a snowball going down a hill, and I think inside Jeremy, he just starts getting more and more and more mad as the episode goes on.
Some of the people that are influential in both of the tribes knew his past... And so it's just one more, like you said, one more thing to add to the snowball as it's going down. But if they hadn't known his past and he never even said anything, I think, you know, he probably wouldn't have been voted out tonight.
You know, it's no different, I think, than just with any friend when you may forgive somebody, but you don't forget. And then when you get pissed off at something, you bring up something that happened like 3 years ago. Like, you know, remember the time you didn't pick me up and you said, it has nothing to do with the argument.
Or subconsciously, you're just like.
Yeah.
You start raging on about him.
Yeah, so that ends, and Wes wins and has Josh go to Exile Island with Keith because he thinks he'll take care of him. And
of course he will.
Yeah. Well, you know, they made a big joke about how it's if you saw a guy from Alabama and a gay guy from the Northeast, you know, you never think they'd be sitting on a beach eating snails together, but they apparently got along really well, so that's cool.
I'm sure they did.
Survivor bringing people together. But while that's happening, though.
Sword fighting.
Oh, God. That's that for this podcast. No.
FCC is going to shut us down. We're not even live.
That's where Jeremy really went back and really filled everybody in on who John Rocker was. And he was a baseball player and the things he said. Although I think.
But is that all even relevant? I mean,
no,
let's think about it.
He was just mad.
Think about it like this. If none of that stuff existed, they wouldn't really have a chance. I mean, he used that as a fuel to the fire to get really to piss, I think, everybody off and to get him against John Rocker.
And it was kind of funny the way he said it because I think he just misspoke. And he goes, he said racist things. He said homosexual things.
Yeah,
I think he meant I think he meant homophobic things.
I think they just threw everything in this basket. And were like, how do we get people to turn on him? And let me just tell them everything I know about the guy.
Yeah.
If none of that stuff existed, people would not have hated him.
Yes, you know, so when we came to the immunity challenge, you could kind of tell something was up. And I actually thought it was pretty funny. They went back and forth, and whenever Rocker was doing something, Jeremy and the team were yelling at him. And then when Jeremy was doing something, Rocker was trying to make him miss. And it was really just like being back in the playground.
Yeah, but everybody was doing it to everyone. I mean, didn't Julia, John Rocker's wife or girlfriend, didn't she get knocked over by... who was it? Was it? No, it wasn't Dale, was it?
To be honest,
no,
I don't even remember what happened in the episode other than John Rocker. It's sad that he's gone because I love to hate him and I love to not hate him.
He's great for television.
And he is.
I think Survivor Production should have done something where he didn't get voted off.
You know, from what sources say, it wouldn't have been the first time they would have done something. But, so as soon as that ends, and of course, Hunapu wins the third. Is it the third? Yeah, I think they've won 5 out of 6 competitions right now.
Yeah.
Oh my God! Something happens, and Natalie loses her mind.
Well, she's the next target if she's that big of a hothead.
But I think her team liked it. Like they rallied around that, and
yeah. But Julie, John Rocker's girlfriend, is on the team with Natalie, and she barely stood up for him. Well,
that's why I think poor Julie might be next on that team. I mean, she's the one she's the odd man out because by no fault. Tell me what you think. I think, you know, Rocker said a bunch of bad things 15 years ago, but I get a sense that he's one of those guys who gets insanely competitive in these type of things, anything, and that's when like he can't shut up because he just gets. There's got to be some redeeming value to him for Julie to want to be with him, right?
I mean, if you take out sports and being competitive and what he said all those years ago, I mean, you're left with a guy. You know, he's a guy at the end of the day, and she probably saw something in him that you know every other girl sees, and I don't know if it's his money, it's big. You know, schlong, whatever it is. He's huge. He's tall. Who the hell knows? What I'm saying is put that aside. He's a guy.
Like, what's...
He's lovable, right? In some ways. I don't know.
That's something that should be applied, I think.
He didn't, dogfight or, kill babies. Like
that we know of.
Yeah.
No. It should be applied in life, in television, reality shows, and even in politics. I've been around a bunch of politicians in my career. And people hate them for what they think they should be standing for. These people are real people. You
know,
they're not
exactly.
Evil. They're not sitting there twirling their mustache. John Rocker isn't thinking about how he can go be a jerk to everybody. He's just living his life. And that may not be a person you want to be around, but it doesn't mean he's evil. It just may mean he's a jerk.
Wait, is John Rocker plotting against the world?
I actually think he's going to take Baylor and tie her to the train tracks when we get back. So,
is that your little fetish?
Oh yeah. So that all goes.
You're
down.
You're all flustered now. You don't know.
I declare. So they get back to the beach, and it's really funny. I don't know if you feel this way. I think we know Cuyopa a lot better because they're always in the end of the episode because they're always going to the to
the. There's going to be no one left.
Tribal
soon.
Council. Yeah. So there was a meeting. Tell me if I'm missing something. Why does everybody seem to not like Baylor?
Well, she's one of two girls left, right?
Yeah, but it seems, I feel like there may be more going on that we don't know because, again, there was a movement to get Baylor out where, I mean, the other girl, I think, is...
Well, because didn't Baylor initially try to align with both sides? She was playing the girls and the guys, and then she was kind of in the middle with Josh.
So I guess the plan turned out to be that they were going to try to get Baylor out. Baylor wanted to get Rocker out, but then Rocker had a plan where he would go to Baylor and tell her they're going to get Dale out.
Right.
Yeah. And in the end, only one could win. And I was really excited when, was it Wes? Someone came from the men and said, you know what? Let's get rid of John Rocker.
It was Josh.
And pretty much everybody rallied around. But I got really scared come tribal council where Jacqueline, wouldn't shut up. The other girl.
Yeah, the one that looks like Laurel from the challenge.
She kept saying well, you know, we've been talking.
Yeah,
and
why would she keep running her mouth? She's not a target. Yeah. Does she want to make herself a target?
No, but they all knew that Rocker had a immunity idol. And he was itching whether to play it or not. And I was like, shut up. Stop talking. I think the rest of them were too, if you saw
their
faces.
He's an idiot for not playing that idol. Let's just talk about that for a second.
But you know what? If he plays it and they keep him, they all of a sudden, what, you didn't trust us? Or what, are you an idiot for using that? I can understand why he didn't, but I definitely would have, because it was not a sure thing. But it was...
Wait, but you play the idol before they cast the votes.
No, it's after they cast the votes, but before they read them.
Oh.
But it's...
He should have played it.
Yeah, and I guess what we don't see are the hours upon hours of them just laying around talking. Like maybe he felt safe that way, you know, the edit... in a certain way, but
yeah, so. And production kind of frustrates me at some points because you don't, they show more, some people more than others, and you don't get a sense of who people really are. So I never felt like he was safe, but
I think there is a Coyopa edit going on that, you know, they're losing, and I think like Phoenix rising from the flames, they may have a comeback, whether it's at Merge or in a little bit.
I think they're going to have to, but I think it's going to be interesting because you only have two females left, right? And then how many males, was it four or five left?
Yeah, well, what they should do is what they should have done in Big Brother. This is where the guys think they're all together, and yeah, suddenly they flip and
yeah,
get someone else
out. Yeah, and that's when everything starts falling apart. And they flipped on John Rocker, their first guy out. So,
and your first opinion, or your first thought is that, why would you get rid of him? He's a big, strong guy. But then you realize he really didn't win anything for that first challenge, in the first episode, he was pretty good.
Why wouldn't you take him... Why wouldn't you take him to the end, quote unquote, the end, if you know he's going to lose? He would never win Survivor, so he was an asset to have with you.
Yeah, but I think they were thinking the short term rather than long term, thinking that if you kept him around, the tribe would just be divisive.
Just divide them all in half, yeah.
Yeah, and they'd be arguing constantly. So, you know, it's cut the cancer out, throw it away, and, you know, we'll see how that goes. It's going to be interesting, but I mean, that's pretty much sums up.
And he didn't use the idol.
But,
what a shame.
But next week, again, if you look back to our first episode and don't pay attention to the quality of the audio, we made some predictions, and one of them that one of those brothers would be a giant douchebag.
Yeah, I like our predictions, actually, and I was totally right.
He's looking. And again, I hope that's not some production trickery to make us think something crazy is going to happen with him, but it looks like he's just going to be a giant jerk. He's one of those guys who sits around and then just badmouths everybody else for doing the same thing. So.
We already knew he was going to be a jerk, which I'm looking forward to. So can any of these people, once they get voted out, are any of them, like, you know how Big Brother...
I don't think so. You know, they used to do that when they had the Redemption Island, but I think with Exile Island, it's good. And I actually prefer it that way. You know, when you're out, you're out. That's it. So... But so on to our next show. It's not necessarily a show that we're watching, but a show that someone might be trying out for. And that song is Utopia. Let's make a brand new star.
That wasn't really the melody of it.
Oh, believe me.
This is Utopia. Let's make a brand new star.
I stand corrected.
It's Daughtry. It's Daughtry.
So what are we doing with Utopia, Lynn?
So I'm actually going to be applying to be on the show. I think, is it every month they have a new person come in? They vote somebody out and then they have somebody come in. It's actually in California, right?
Yeah, I'm a little unclear on the timeline, actually, and I should know because I watch it, but it just...
I don't know because it says between October 1 and October 31st, you can, you know, submit your applications. I think it's on a rolling basis, but I think it's once a month they have a new person come in. So.
Are you going to be like Huntress Elaine and go, there's only room for one Huntress? Get out of here. Hex.
No, I'm going to be like polyamorous Dedeker.
You know, you're just digging yourself a bigger hole in with your boyfriend every episode, whether it's Beast Mode Cowboy or being polyamorous.
Oh, my God.
No, really, what would you, if you could pick... Like the adjective before your name, what would it be?
You mean the one that's already been used, or just something that's
the one that's
the libertarian
one that's
Elaine.
No. Just pick a brand new one that's acceptable for TV that they can actually say.
And I mean, it would probably just have to be what I've been is defense contractor Elaine, but it just sounds so stupid.
Crazy Elaine.
Who knows? I don't. I mean, how do they even?
I don't know. Anyway, so what would be your utopia?
So that's one of the questions that they ask you in your little online thing. It's like, what's your perfect utopia? And I really don't have a question to that. I'll probably create some fluff for them. But they ask, one of the first things they ask you is, are you, you know, your status in terms of single, married, boyfriend, girlfriend? And I feel like...
I think you're gonna lie on that one, right?
You have to say you're single.
I think they like that because I think then you'll get naked and sleep
and
with somebody
around
in the barn
yeah.
or something.
Yeah. I don't know. Should I lie on
Why don't you
I
tell them that you want a government based on like the Roman Empire, the Roman Republic, maybe senators and wearing togas. Like something, I think if you had something like crazy but believable, they would pick you. But
so one of the things is they said, why do you want to come to Utopia? Blah, blah, blah. And I said, because Utopia doesn't have a strong leader. Everyone there is just like pussy whipped by the guy, what is it, the New Yorker with the shabby hair?
Well, he's the most sane one.
Is he? I feel like he just is just like, oh yeah, we're like okay.
Well, see, the difference is, I think they said one of the last episode of the episode before was that there are too many leaders and you need five. I think it's too many people who think they're leaders, but people who don't actually know what that means.
So I'm actually not a leader at all. I'm not a leader at all.
You're going to lead us off the cliff like with the lemmings.
I'm not a leader. I'm a very outgoing personality, but I don't lead at all. And I told them in the thing, I said, I'm a huge leader and I want to come in and, you know, they need some guidance and I want to be that leader. But when I get there, I'm just going to be like...
I want you to start stomping on cans like Red.
I'm going to be libertarian. What's his name?
Rob? You can libertarian. Be can stomper lady.
What's her name that like meditates in the garden?
Oh, no, it's my garden. I'm so sad. Oh, God. So
yoga instructor. I'm just like.
So I assume you'll keep us updated on the progress and with you here from Utopia. Because seriously, at this point, who the heck knows how many people are actually... asking to be on the show.
Like, exactly.
You see how many people show chances, up.
Yeah. So the other thing is they usually, like, I guess it's every week, they have people come mm-hmm. into the actual gates of Utopia, yep. and then they do different, like, yoga classes, different things to earn money. And, I mean, there's people watching the show, but if you look at the numbers and the people who actually show up to some of these activities that Utopia is doing, it's about, like, 20 to 30 people at most.
Well, if you listen to Jacoby on the Right Reasons podcast, which, shout out to you guys, I love you. He actually is in the California, Los Angeles area, and he just emailed them about getting on the show, and they're like freaked out because I guess somebody wanted to be on there, and they emailed him back, they followed him on Twitter, they did all these things. So I think if you're in the area, you can definitely visit. So how hard can it be to actually get on there? I think you're golden.
Would they fly me out? I mean, if they wanted me to be on there, I'm in D.C., they're in L.A., would they actually spend the money?
And here's actually the first thing you talk about when you get on there. You go, I need money to buy a computer and microphone to do my podcast from Utopia. And if they don't give it to you, you freak out and destroy everything.
Bring me your torch podcast. Bring me your torch. What do you plug in here?
Bring me your Utopia podcast. We have to change the name, I think.
I know. Oh, my gosh.
Oh, goodness. So
stay tuned, guys.
Yes. So as we mentioned last week, one of our favorite shows came back.
Are we going to the next subject now?
We are.
Okay.
Do you have more to say? I'm sorry.
The listeners just need to know that we're moving on to our next subject.
My bad. Bar Rescue came back.
Yes.
With the great John Taffer, who, as we all know, doesn't embrace excuses. He embraces solutions. Makes funny faces while doing it. So anyways, this one was, she's making a face at me right now, was at a bar. Now, I want to tell you the name of the bar on Long Island, but I think it's pretty unclear.
Long Island? What's Huntington?
It is Long Island. That's Long Island. Yeah. That it has one of two names. It was called the Artful Dodger, but then it was also called Radio, although they changed the name to Radio, but didn't change the signs or anything else. And it was...
Why is it the Dodgers? Is it that?
No, the Artful Dodger. I think it was from, was it from Catcher in the Rye? It was from one of the books. I should have paid attention to it more. But it was, I actually think it's kind of a cool name, but... I mean,
it's a roach motel. Well, not roach, mosquito and fruit fly hotel.
It's after watching all these TV shows and these reality shows, I really think that owning a business is for a specific kind of person. I'm not that person because I think it would end up something like the Artful Dodger. It's
just bugs everywhere.
Yeah, well, you know, it's one of those things I think just spirals out of control pretty quickly. But if you had watched the show, this bar was one of those places that was happening like 5 years ago, and then suddenly other bars opened up around it, and they didn't really update or do anything nice with their place, and it became a crap hole, and no one came there.
No, they had one big issue that we're completely overlooking.
Well, let's go about how it came to be. So nothing was going on there, and John Taffer, through his secret cameras and video, was... watching what was going on and said, you know what, these guys are just sitting around doing nothing and we need to get people in there. So they got about 100 people they paid to go there, and one of their undercover people went to get a drink and she was drinking it and looked at the bottom of her glass. What did she say?
Mosquitoes. Oh, yeah. Cockroaches? Oh, no. No. Crickets? No. Fruit flies.
Fruit flies. You know, fifth time's the charm, I think, right? Yeah.
No. I got it eventually. No. It was one of those bugs.
And not appetizing?
Say the least.
Yeah. So she went and got a new one. And what happened with the new one?
More fruit flies.
And so this was like, at this point, there were a couple of classic, what I call taphorisms, that were brought in. The first one was, I've got people drinking bugs and an owner who doesn't do anything about it. And he busts out of his car out of there because he gets sick. And then he's talking to the owner. And so they have a promoter who, as far as I can tell, isn't really promoting anything. And you have an owner who's really just sitting on his butt while it's going down the hill. And they're both blaming each other. And Taffer looks at him and goes, this is your future, man. And you walk around like an idiot and do nothing about it. But there's something about the way that he says it. And his facial and his whole body—he's like swinging his arms around,
like having a stroke.
Kind of like a gorilla, like losing his mind. It's so, but I mean that with like the most respect, and I mean that with the best possible.
He's
awesome.
Hopefully, one day we'd be able to get him on our podcast.
My brother was in New Orleans a couple months ago, and Taffer was at the bar that they did down there, and they were going to go, I think it was Spirit on Bourbon Street, I think was the name of it, and he goes down there, and he missed him by 15 minutes. He just left, and I was,
What?
Yeah, so, oh well, but,
I'd be so mad.
So, and not only do they have fruit flies, they've resorted to having 18 and overnight, and I don't know. I guess that's pretty cool when you're under 21, but when you're over 21, it's like a bunch of kids.
I feel like 18 and over establishments should generally be like booty shaking clubs.
Yes. To where you focused on the TNA and less on the beer. Right?
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Dance floor, you know, ass out kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. Because as John Taffer showed, it's almost impossible to not serve these kids. As a guy who was once a child and knew what it was like to be underage but still want to drink, you find ways.
Oh, yeah.
You know, you can't stop.
Especially if you're a female. There's plenty of overage guys there that want to take advantage of young females who are drunk. So why not give them some alcohol?
You can only hope to contain it. So
What's the, they keep getting younger. What is that?
No, as Matthew McConaughey said in, that's what I love about high school girls. I get older and they stay the same age.
That's awesome.
Days confused.
Oh, my gosh.
Yep. Oh,
so that's pretty much the anthem of that place.
Yeah, so he brought in a couple of people, and I wanted to point out, because we're recording this in Washington, D.C., they brought in Jesse Barnes from the Park on 14th. In the Park 14th. Park and 14th?
Who the hell is he?
Have you ever been? Yeah, so I'm assuming you've never been there.
No.
Is it high end? Like what? I think we got to look into that and possibly.
Is this one of those yuppie places that just opened a parking lot into like this posh?
I did a little research on that. Her father, Mark Barnes, is the owner of the park on 14th and of a bar called Love, which I've never heard of either. And he was once known as
the Love Nightclub?
Yeah, have you heard of that?
Yeah.
Oh, where is it?
I think it's over by, is it not New York Avenue?
I don't know.
No, I don't
they
know.
Don't
who
care.
Knows? No one cares. Yeah, sorry, guys.
We're having this for our own personal discussion here, sorry. But
who cares?
But he was once called the king of DC clubs, so that's how she got into it. So I think now. They also talk about, I think in past episodes, about how they have bottle service there. And I feel it's one of those clubs you go to and you sit in the couch and they bring you over like $1,000 bottle of pop off and that kind of stuff.
You mean $1,000 bottle of like Grey Goose? And they just like.
But I think it's only fair that we look into this and possibly try to go there at some point and.
Get him on our podcast?
That well, at least
would
like,
be the only interest I would have is to actually get him on
it's
the
like,
show.
It's like seeing these guys in their natural environment.
Well, that's why you go to Top Chef restaurants, except you actually have decent food there.
Well, yeah, so I'm how many episodes? We're two episodes? This is the first episode, sorry.
First episode.
I want Chef Brian Duffy.
Oh,
he's
yeah.
the man.
Oh, God.
Forget that Irish guy. Yeah, no disrespect to the Irish, but I'm not a fan of that guy.
That guy is, like, asexual. I don't know.
I want Brian Duffy because Taffer almost got into a fight with a guy over him, and he's the best.
If Taffer's standing up for somebody, I'll put my life on the line for that same person.
Oh, yeah.
That's how strong I am behind Don Taffer.
I'm with you 100 million percent.
So if he's obsessed with Brian Duffy, I'm obsessed with Brian
Duffy.
Damn
straight.
Whatever Taffer wants to do, Taffer can do.
So you know, they did their whole rigmarole. He screamed at all of them, got them into shape, redid it, and they turned it into a place called P&Q Auto Body, which is...
P&Q Auto Body.
Yeah, mind your P's and Q's, pints and quarts. But it's like an old school speakeasy. So you go there, and it looks like an auto dealership, and then you push through, and suddenly you're into a bar. But actually, that was pretty cool. But the thing is, if you're just out walking around looking for a bar, you're not going to see it. You're going to be like, oh, it's an auto body shop.
Well, you're going to Google it, because everyone has a smartphone these days, yeah. And you're going to say, you know, bars in this area, and nothing's, it's not going to come up. I mean, it's a bad, what is it, search operating, yeah, what is, I mean, the SOP, search,
maybe you
search optimization, what is it?
POS, point of service system. No, I know
what you're saying.
But so, yeah, the keyword's not going to be there. Branding. Unless it's called P&Q's Auto Body in Saloon or something like that.
Exactly.
I don't know, it's kind of cool, but I'd be interested to go see exactly where it is today.
Another thing, I don't know how affluent Huntington is, because I'm assuming it's very affluent, right? Because I'm a fairly educated, I have my bachelor's from American University, fairly educated. I don't know what the hell P's and Q's are. Like, I get the whole idea of a speakeasy, actually never been to one, but like, I feel like even when you tell me it, I get it, but it takes me 10 minutes to process.
And you're an educated woman.
And I'm so I'm just wondering if the people catch on to this quickly. I mean,
oh, you could call a bar, you know, booby statues, and it will make no sense if people go there and if it has good deals.
Yeah, but when you put auto body or whatever after it, it's very misleading.
I bet you there's some modification going on there at some point.
The issue is it's only going to attract locals, because
I think actually if you kept it all the same but changed the name so that it was obviously a bar, wouldn't be bad.
Maybe you should put speakeasy after it.
P&Q speakeasy. Okay. So
sorry, I'm entertaining myself.
No,
at this
yeah,
point.
Yeah. But you guys don't realize that we try to make this podcast a little more natural flow, but then we realize when we start doing that, we just start entertaining ourselves and we don't entertain you guys. So sorry, we're trying to find a nice middle ground there.
Yeah, we don't have to want to edit any of this out. Yeah. All right, let's move along.
Yeah, so we're in the pop culture now.
Oh, great.
And I think you have something to say.
About what?
You picked the topics. Well, the first one was...
It's hard when you don't have your computer in front of you.
A couple weeks ago, a couple months ago, the Palins got into a family brawl.
Why is this coming out just now, though? I don't understand.
No, it's been ongoing, I guess you'd say.
Okay.
And I guess it came out that one of the things that started it was that...
This is Labor Day weekend, by the way.
Yeah, was that... Is it Bristol?
Bristol.
Was a quote-unquote slut-shamed. There's been a lot of that going on. Last week it was Christine. What are you freaking out about?
Slut-shaming. I love it.
What's they called?
There's this list of, like, Christine from Big Brother, and then Mila Kunis, and then now...
That goes... What? So anyway, see that me later on? Anyways.
Congratulations, she was, by the way. Yeah,
So they got apparently they got into the fight and they were just screaming things at them and they started calling her some choice words. And again, going back, this goes back to what we were talking about with John Rocker. I'm not a fan of the Palins, but there are many people out there who think they're evil. They're just not my cup of tea. So I think the Palins were probably the worst, but these people who were starting the fight were probably the worst. And it's, you know, you have a couple of drinks in you and suddenly you say the stupidest things.
The people who I think they were arguing with were actually lived at the house. So I think that makes a little bit worse when the Palins are coming into your house.
Yeah, and it's...
And not having some sort of doing a campaign, but they're actually, you know, bitching you out.
You know, I kind of want to say I wish the Palins would go away, but I said, you know what? She's living the American dream. She got out of public life and is going around making speeches and getting lots and lots of money for it. And heck, I do
it. She's famous for being famous now.
I would do that if I could.
Yeah, I mean, I don't want them to go away. I'm by no means a Palin supporter, but I think it's very entertaining when I see, you know, the whole family had a brawl on, and now it's across TMZ. I think it's very, you know, it's entertaining.
Hey, it is strong family values. They fight together.
Oh, they stated the family that fights together.
Yeah.
The family that brawls together, I don't have a good thing.
I was trying really hard. I couldn't think of it either. So,
but I heard that Sarah Palin is actually proud of her daughter, Bristol, for getting in a fight.
Don't take no crap from nobody.
Oh, hell no.
Don't you know?
Yeehaw!
She's from Alaska, though.
Sorry. Yeah, wrong accent.
Well,
there.
Well, this next thing we're talking about is something that you've wanted us to talk about for a couple weeks now.
Yeah, it's old news now.
I actually didn't know about it until today. I looked it up today as the Maroon 5 Animals video. I mean, what was your thoughts on that video?
I actually thought it was kind of offensive, and it takes a lot for me. I mean, you know me.
I'm going to take the counterpoint on this.
You listen to our podcast. You guys listen to our podcast. You know exactly what we're talking about. I'm, you know, obviously the stuff that comes out of my mouth, you know, I'm very sort of liberal in that sense. I'll say whatever, but this video of Adam Levine in a, what is it, in a butcher's manufacturer, what is it, beef manufacturer, industrial kind of thing?
Rocky did it. We gave him an Oscar for that first movie.
Yeah, but this kind of, these images with him with an axe or a machete or whatever the hell you want, a butcher knife, or, you know, with blood all over it and all over his body, coupled with the second image of him walking down the street, looking and peering at his, I guess this is actually his girlfriend or his wife now, fiance.
Oh, in real life, you mean?
In real life.
Okay,
this is
yeah,
it.
Yeah.
But he's... from afar, he's quote unquote, you know, stalking this young lady who is she's just casually walking down the street, you know, going about her daily life, woohoo, with her eyes and head in the sky, pretty much. And he's peering around corners, and then they flip back to the butcher scene where he's literally, as is, I think he's slaughtering like things of meat, or he's hanging on slabs of meat actually with blood all over his body. So, you know, as you can tell, a lot of organizations aren't too happy about this.
Here's my counterpoint on this. Obviously stalking is not good, but
really,
it is a music video. Now, do you think whoever the character he was playing in that video, do you think he came off as being a positive character or like a disturbed character?
Disturbed, obviously.
So there was a movie that came out a decade ago maybe with Robin Williams called One Hour Photo, where he became obsessed and stalked the family through the 1 hour photos and stuff. But guess what? It was, no one wanted to yell at Robin Williams. It was a role. This is a music video. And he can, and in the end, he, from what I can tell, unless those were metaphors for something. He didn't actually do anything to her. It looks like he was, from what I gather from the video, he was a very meek person who from afar had these visions of sleeping with her and
killing her.
Yeah. Well, I don't know if that's clear, but
that's pretty clear.
Here's what I go back to. A song I actually love, and I actually love the video. I told Elena about this right before we started, that Sugarland had a video called Stuck Like Glue. It came out a few years ago. And the entire video is about, it's funny, if you hear the song, it sounds like a love song. Then you watch the video, it's about her being obsessed with the guy and like almost running him down with a car, kidnapping him several times, tying him to a chair, and then force feeding him cake with their picture on it. And now the video is more lighthearted.
I was going to say, what's the tone of the video?
The tone of the video is lighthearted. But the subject matter is exactly the same.
This one... you know, if you listen to the song, Animal, I mean, just the title, Animal, is pretty much saying humans are barbaric. And there's been a lot, obviously, over history of violence against women. I don't know if you've ever heard of something like that.
No.
Oh, really? Okay, all right, whatever. So you're very clandestine about this, and obviously you support violence against women.
Obviously. No, what I do support is that there are a lot of things in this world to be upset about. To me... putting your efforts into a music video, you know, when I looked at it, I didn't actually care for the video. So you know what? I'm not going to watch it again.
I wanted to talk about it because it's controversial.
Okay, I'm not messing with you bringing it up.
But I'm saying there's organizations out there like Mothers Against Drunk Driving.
Who are obsessed.
Sorry, I'm cracking myself up again. Who are obsessed over, you know, finding these different symbols, I guess, in society that really support violence against women. And then they counter them. And that's their job. That's what they do. Mothers Against Drunk Driving does it.
Those are more obsessed with drunk driving as opposed to violence. But I think as it comes to any kind of controversial opinion, we can just agree to disagree. But we can agree that violence towards anybody, not good. You want to talk a little bit about Adrian Peterson.
I know more about this.
He's your favorite football player out here, right?
I don't have a favorite.
I'm just joking. She hates football.
Anytime I can, I just placed my first bet and I won. It was against the Redskins.
Do you like their uniforms? That's why.
No. You're leading me in.
No. So
you're leading me.
As anybody who's followed the news lately, you can tell that Adrian Peterson is kind of a dummy.
Really?
Yeah. Well, you know, I know it's a cultural thing, but he reprimanded his kid a few months ago or a few weeks ago, more than I would have, more than I think people should.
Is this the guy with the switch that was beating his kid?
Exactly who he is.
Or is that the other guy?
Yeah. So, and if you can't tell, our pop culture news has taken a bizarrely dark turn this week. Don't hold that. It gets darker. Don't worry.
But it's just because celebrities are doing really barbaric things.
You know, we report on what happened, whether it's happy or not. But so this week, they want to prosecute him again because when he was giving a urine test, he mentioned that he was smoking marijuana. And
when he was giving a urine test, he's mentioning that he's smoking marijuana. Yeah. Now, did they find it in his urine or?
To be honest, that would have required more research than I did before this podcast. But I just did a quick read off of TMZ. Yeah. But it's that people, prosecutors like.
He's already on probation. So once you violate probation.
Keep your mouth shut, Adrian Peterson. I think, though, it's what's good about this whole thing is that you can just because you're a celebrity, just because you're a just because you can run really fast doesn't mean you can get away with doing things. And, you know, we'll see how this all plays out.
Didn't like half the Ravens almost go to jail for like killing people or abuse?
There's been one after another of just football in general this year. So, but on to a happier note, let's welcome a brand new addition to this world, a brand new Kutcher, if it would be. Ashton Kutcher and Mila Kunis have had
Mila Kunis.
I should know that since I love her. Had their first.
Do you? I feel like you think she's just like.
Well, here's why. One of my favorite movies of the past 10 years, Forgetting Sarah Marshall, and she was fantastic in that movie. She was the girl next door, as you would, though of course very beautiful girl next door. But the problem I have now, after knowing she was dating
Spawn of Satan,
she is. There's no other word to put it. Forever unclean.
Why?
She's been contaminated by the seed of Kutcher. I mean, I guess he's good looking, but he's...
No, he's not.
No, good.
Not,
thank you. He's just the worst. He's a bad actor. 2 and a Half Men is horrible with him in it. Not that it was an Emmy... Well, not that it was... Not
is it over? What do you mean was?
This is the last season. Well, it's the last season.
Thank
but
God.
I've just kind of crossed out of my mind and pretended that our boy Charlie Sheen, when he left, that was the end. But I'm just glad.
He just reminds me of one of those kids in high school, those douchebags that I really just didn't like. The one of the tall white kids that maybe played basketball, was really popular, tried to bang all the cheerleaders.
Wore a trucker hat like Kutcher did it. And
yeah,
punked.
Was like a year ahead of everyone in fashion, but just wore it terribly. I mean, he's just,
So
he's a douchebag.
But if you're listening to this, Ashton, I'm just joking, and please come on the podcast. We'd be happy to talk to you. We kid.
No, I don't want him on here.
You know.
I'm sorry. I'm just keeping it real. Like, I don't want Ashton Kutcher on my podcast. I'll forever.
I tried, Ashton. I tried.
I'll get Demi Moore, though.
I'll take her, too. So our last piece of news, and unquestionably the most disturbing, is I never watched this show. Did you watch Seventh Heaven?
From time to time, yeah, just because of, what is her name? Jessica Biel.
I was more of a Lorelai fan from Gilmore Girls, although I didn't watch that show either. So the father in that, Stephen Collins, who always seemed like a really nice guy, maybe it's just they're actors that can do that, was basically just came out that he had molested 3 children. And his wife, I guess, who he's having a divorce with, taped it, and it came out. And it's... I mean, I don't know if there's anything
I wish, like, we could play some of the footage on here, because I haven't actually heard it.
Well, we'll talk about it afterward. It's actually really depressing, because not only...
So what does it say?
He basically just says, I've...
She asked him straight up, and was like...
Yeah, and it's unquestionable. So he's resigned from the Screen Actors Guild, and he's pulled out of Ted 2. But, you know, it's just...
What was he in Ted...
I don't remember, but...
Ted 2?
I don't know.
Who knows?
But so it's good to hell off it. It's good to happier things because I'm just
getting
sadder.
Yeah, I'm already feeling uncomfortable, and I know our listeners probably don't want to hear about
this. They're
probably
not even listening anymore at this point. It's the this is the reality show and depressing news podcast.
It keeps on giving. It's a reality show that keeps on giving.
So on to TV that we should watch this week.
Yay!
This is a TV show that I've been hearing a lot about lately, and when I brought it up to Elaine, she almost flipped her lid of excitement. This show is Below Deck.
I always want to call it Overboard for some reason.
That's an old. That's a movie with Goldie Hawn and Russell.
Yeah, I love it.
So I've only watched the first episode, and I'm in, but I need to find a chunk of time where I can just sit there. Maybe this week and just binge the entire thing.
Yeah, so how many seasons have there been?
This is the second season.
Second season.
I think it's probably getting towards the end of the second season right now.
Oh, really?
Yeah. But so I don't know enough of who anybody is, but...
Well, they constantly have people change on there.
I think there's a set group, but then in the second season they brought back some, but not others.
And yeah.
I don't know. I shouldn't even be talking about it because I really don't even know what I'm saying.
Well, it's hard to keep up with it though, because like you said, they have that set group and it's a small group.
Yeah. You have the captain, you have the first mate, and it's like any of these shows.
But you probably have about 10 people, 12 people on the crew, the people that do the below deck stuff, and then the above deck. Kind of like, you know, the chef and, like you said, the captain.
Well, and they all just do stupid stuff and sleep with each other and get drunk and all the idiots who go on board.
And then, but the whole part of the show is the different clients and customers.
And they're always, but there's always some kind of...
drama, whether it's... Did you see the penis episode?
I have not seen
it. I won't spoil it for you or everybody else, okay. But next week we'll talk about it a little bit more, hopefully. And we'll have binge-watched most of the episodes, but I do highly recommend, what is it, Above Deck, Below Deck?
Below Deck.
I don't know.
It's such a good show, I have no idea what it's called.
It's a great show, and it's on Bravo.
The next show.
Highly recommend it.
We're
going
to move away from this because we have nothing else to say. The next show.
Awkward.
Yes, and it's funny that I looked on the rundown, and Elaine wrote, awkward-for our younger viewers. But guess what? I watch it.
No, I didn't say younger viewers. I said younger
listeners. Whatever. They're viewing it on a webpage, which is www.bringyourtorch.com.
Yes.
So do you want to tell us a little bit about what the show is?
Awkward follows a teenager. What's her name?
Jenna Hamilton,
who is actually in real life. She's, I think, in her mid-20s. And it follows her around high school, and she has a bunch of characters. Her boyfriend, on and off again, Maddie. Her best friend, Tamara.
Well, the whole thing started off though because she like tripped and fell down and like broke a whole bunch of her bones, and the rumor was that she tried to kill herself. So everybody was like, "Oh yeah, that's the girl I tried to kill." That's the first season.
That's the first season.
Then it's really just been the teen angst and. But I actually think it's pretty good humor.
It's great humor, and I like the way if you're over 30 and you want to know what the young kids are talking about and the lingo and stuff, it's great to kind of keep up on.
Tamara's pretty ridiculous though she's
always speaking in acronyms, and it's good for younger pop culture.
But all these shows always make me feel like I was such a loser in high school. God, they're dating and sleeping with more people than I think I have in my entire life till now. It's like, good God, it's crazy.
I was such a loser in high school. I love
what do you mean in high school?
Hey.
Just kidding.
I love the way their rooms, Jenna's rooms decorated, the way that they manipulate social media and technology in their lives as teenagers. Mm. I wish I had the Facebook and the Skype and all that stuff.
They had everything, the YouTube and the interwebs. As we move away from this, to quote character Sadie, watch Awkward. You're welcome.
I love Sadie. She's such a pain in the ass, but she's great.
The number one big show coming back is the number one show on TV.
This is why Jesse and I bonded.
It's why Elaine still thinks it's going to be a zombie apocalypse any day.
Well, it's the reason why I was intently following the zombie outbreak in Florida 2 years ago. And
people were eating.
In Miami.
True story. The Walking Dead is coming back this Sunday, 9 o'clock, I think, on... AMC, and I'm a comic book nerd. I will admit that. I have all the issues. I think we're up to about issue 127 or 29 or 30, something along those lines. And what's really interesting about this season, this is the first season where the show is totally deviating from the comic books. So in the past, I could pretty much guess what was going to happen from scene to scene. Not now. This is all brand new stuff.
Really? Yeah. Why?
Well, I guess you branch out into your own world.
Yeah. So that the comic books ended in that case then?
No. It's just they're deviating. So the storylines are going to be different. So what do you think is going to happen in this? What are your thoughts on where they were left off at the end of last season? Where's it going?
I think they're going to... Is it breaking out of the box? Isn't that...
But the big rumor was they're cannibals.
Yeah, that's what I figured. Yeah. I mean, they're going to kill him and eat him. I mean, how else are they going to get there?
When they first got there, they all handed them food. It's like, well, what are you eating? And my mother actually pointed this out to me because I was too busy going, oh, my God. At the end, when they're running around, they go by someplace and there's like a pen of like bloody bones.
Yeah, exactly. That's what they insinuate, doesn't it?
But so. It's interesting because it's really confusing watching the trailers for this new season because it seems like they're out pretty quickly, but I think I've also read that the trailer is nonlinear, so you can't be sure what's going to happen, but you know, someone's going to die, I'm sure. It's The Walking Dead.
It's not going to be, you know, the main cast will probably still be intact, and they'll probably make their way up to, where are they going, Washington, D.C.?
But you know what, if you read the comic books, you know nobody is safe, so...
Yeah, but then they wouldn't have a show. So my guess is that they're all going to get out of there and
the most exciting thing, though, is that if you didn't just watch, you read on the back on the interwebs that they're already planning a thing with a character called Negan, or Negan, however you want to pronounce it.
Negan, is that like Megan?
He's a huge, he's the number one villain to come after the governor. So it's going to be big when that happens. That'll be probably in a year or two. We'll see when that happens. But I'm going to be watching. I don't know about you. I'm excited.
Definitely going to be watching. I love zombies.
All right, so next, you want to talk about a show that I've actually never heard of nor watched, Somebody's Got to Do It on CNN with Mike Rowe. Have at it, because I have nothing to say.
The thing about this show, though, is, of course you haven't seen it because it hasn't been on yet. I think there's been one episode so far. And Mike Rowe was the same guy who did Dirty Jobs.
I know who he is. I just have no idea. What's the show about?
I actually have no idea.
Guys, watch the show. I don't know what it's about.
But, I don't know what it's about.
Well, no, there you go.
He was on CNN the other day and said that this show had nothing to do with Dirty Jobs.
Yes.
But I don't entirely believe that. So my best guess from what he described the show to be is pretty much a continuation of what Dirty Jobs was. Pretty much anything that people don't want to do. Cleaning toilets, things like that.
Recording this podcast.
Recording this. We should have Mike Rowe here and be like, watch us.
Somebody's got to do it. I guess I'll be honest. Well, I guess we'll keep an eye out for that show.
I'm
and see
excited
how it is.
About it, actually.
I'm not, but, you know, report back to us. Let us know what it's about. The next one I am equally interested in, but, you know, my views aren't important. It's what our listeners want to hear. I said listeners, not viewers this time, which is pretty cool.
Finally.
It's yet another Real Housewives, this time the Real Housewives of Atlanta, which is coming back on November 9th.
I am so excited about this one because this is actually the seventh season. This is the Real Housewives of Atlanta, and there's one original housewife, and if you want to call her housewife, she works her butt off doing what God knows, but... She gets
maybe
paid.
She's a social media mogul like Frankie.
She's a social media mogul. But she's apparently getting paid $1.5 million to do this this next season, the seventh season.
I guess people are watching it. I'm not. But, you know, there are a lot of these shows out that I don't watch and people do.
Have you ever watched any of The Real Housewives?
I've not watched that. I've not watched Shaws of Sunset. Have not watched a Kardashian show.
You know who NeNe
I know
Leakes
she is.
Is
from The Celebrity Apprentice. And I didn't, really, I didn't much care for her.
The New Normal, anything like that. I didn't watch that either, but apparently she was on that until it got canceled.
Fun. We'll watch that. I have two more things I want to talk about quickly before we end this. Is the first show, it's coming back this Sunday also. I believe it's on Showtime. Again, I should know that. Shame on me for not. But it's called The Affair, and it's a 10-episode drama from the creative team that brought you In Treatment. I don't know if you ever watched that. Ron, your boyfriend, loves that show because it's basically a therapist. And there were five episodes a week, and every episode was a character, and it was just phenomenal. But anyways, it's about an affair, and it's the effects of this affair on both people, but it's from both perspectives. So I don't know if they're both cheating, but it has a good cast.
Is it a reality
show? No, it's real. And it's with Dominic West, who was in The Wire, Joshua
what
Jackson.
What do you mean it's real?
What do you mean it's real?
I said, is it a reality show? You're like, it's real.
No, I said, no, I'm sorry. It's a real TV show. It's a scripted show,
okay,
my bad.
It's a scripted show.
No,
okay.
It's not. It's not reality. That would be way too depressing to watch.
Is it a reality show? It's real.
It's real to me. All right. The last show I want to talk about really quickly is something we mentioned last week. I just want to throw it out there again. Are You the One, MTV? Mondays, watch it. The big...
I tried to watch this. I couldn't get into it.
It's the best. The big twist this year, instead of having 20 men and 20 women, or excuse me, 10 women and 10 men, they have 10 men and 11 women. One person has two matches. And whoever gets matched first, the other one, goodbye, you get no money. So, of course, they all hate that woman.
It sounds like... Well, does anyone get voted off, or do they all just stay in there? Because it sounds like... Bachelor Paradise. Were you watching Bachelor?
I'm not. I really should, though.
But really, you need to
I've
get
tried,
into
and I hear things about it, but I just, I've never given a chance to really get into
Bachelor,
it.
Bachelor.
I watch the first episode when I see all the ridiculous people and the things they do, but after that, I really just can't.
Well, they have a lot of spinoffs, and one of them was Bachelor in Paradise or whatever it was.
I have heard good things about that, I'm going to be honest.
All right.
Well, I want to end this on a kind of a, another sad note, but I want to tell everybody about this. That
don't end on a sad note. I have to. You have to give our listeners what they want. Well, they want to feel good today.
You know, anybody who's listening knows that we love MTV's The Challenge. It's one of our favorite shows. And one of the people I've always loved on there is DM Brown. She's a cancer survivor. She's very strong. She had a relationship with CT a lot. It was one of the main points of the show. And
she's brilliant.
Yeah. And so back in August, she was filming her eighth season of The Challenge, and she collapsed on set. She was airlifted to New York, and it was announced that she had colon cancer, and they had to perform emergency surgery on her.
That's horrible. And
it's really been an ongoing thing. She's been trying to blog and trying to put things on to let people know how things are going, but it's just, you know, it's just really, really sad. She was so strong in the past, really documenting her last battle with cancer. So the reason I'm bringing this all up is not to depress everybody, but I want to tell everybody about a website called www.medgift.com. And there, not just DM, but anybody who is suffering from cancer and going through treatment, you can donate money to them. And there are children on there. There are adults, people of all sizes. And I think everybody should just go there to medgift.com and check it out.
Hold on, I'm writing it down. What is it again?
It's medgift.com.
Okay, medgift.com.
You bet.
Okay,
and it really helps out anybody you can do. So that's, we're going to leave you on there. But on a happy note, we've just completed our third podcast.
Finally.
Hopefully we didn't bore you. Hopefully we entertained you. And hopefully you're going to come back for the next one, because we want to see your clicks on our download page. Because
like us on Facebook.
Like us on Facebook. Search for Bring Me Your Torch. Like us on Twitter. Search for Bring Me Your Torque, because it wouldn't let me put the H on. It was too long. And of course, you can visit everything we do on www.bringmeyourtorch.com. Yeah, so.
That's awesome.
I'm going to leave you with the quote we always do with my good friend John Taffer, that if this is your first time listening to our podcast, you came here as a stranger, but we're leaving as friends. We'll see you next time.
Have a good night.
Bye-bye.